Six words. Six little words is all it took to spark the imagination of thousands.
You fought in the Clone Wars?
In 1977, Star Wars was released and captivated audiences all over the world through the combination of solid storytelling, incredible special effects, and lovable characters. I'm not going to dive too heavily into the history books on this one, but suffice it to say that when George Lucas first approached production companies to secure a budget for his science fiction, fantasy, space opera, no one was exactly fighting for the chance to helm the project. United Artists, Universal Pictures, and ironically, even Walt Disney Productions were some of the few companies to turn Lucas down. Given we all now know of Star Wars as one of, if not the biggest franchise in the world, it's amazing to me that intentionally or unintentionally, George Lucas was able to conceptualize these now integral parts of the Star Wars canon before the first film even became a hit. After 12 years, The Clone Wars has finally wrapped up its last season this year on Disney Plus. But before I get to that series, I want to talk about its now lesser known big brother, and to do that, we need to go back to 2003. Star Wars Clone Wars was a three-season animated micro-series that aired on Cartoon Network and was produced and directed by Genndy Tartakovsky, also known for his work on popular Cartoon Network shows Dexter's Laboratory and Samurai Jack. Consisting of 25 episodes in total, the three seasons eventually split into volumes 1 and 2, helped bridge the gap between episodes 2 and 3, and even introduced popular characters such as Asajj Ventress and most notably General Grievous, albeit with slight differences. Sadly, since Disney's acquisition in 2012, the series is now considered non-canon, but this did allow for the 2008 series more freedom when telling their version of the events. All that aside, if you consider yourself a Star Wars fan and haven't watched the series, I could not recommend it more. It definitely has this larger-than-life feel to it, and by that I mean pretty much every character took a big hit of Force steroids during their pre-workout. You got Kit Fisto making destructive Force water balls. You got Mace Windu with possibly the biggest clutch win of all time. You got a beautiful speeder bike dismount from Obi-Wan. Even the clone troopers can one man an AAT.
Woo! It's showtime!
The first two seasons up to episode 20 didn't focus too heavily on a single story, but instead centered on multiple skirmishes across the war. Whereas the final season's five episodes told a much more cohesive narrative, dealing with Anakin's ascent to Jedi Knight and the invasion of Coruscant to tie into the opening of episode 3. It has to be said that the highlight of the last few episodes is without a doubt the introduction of General Grievous. The setup for this version of the character is perfect. In the final episode of the second season, Obi-Wan receives a distress call from Master Barrack, before it is cut off and we are shown a destroyed Republic assault ship where six Jedi are hiding, left devastated by whatever is hunting them. And then we get this. This scene, along with his part during the invasion of Coruscant, is the most cold and vicious version of the character. And my only wish is more characteristics of this interpretation made it into episode 3 and the 2008 series, as he made for a truly terrifying villain. Go check out the series if you haven't already, you can easily find it in full on YouTube. Whilst it may no longer be considered canon, it's got great action, really slick animation, and the presentation still holds up incredibly well today. And at the end of the day, it's just more top quality Star Wars, what else can I say? Now we get to 2008. It's hard to remember at times, but the 2008 Clone Wars series actually kicked off as a full-length feature film, which also doubled as the pilot for the series. Looking back on it now, the plot isn't exactly thrilling, especially coming off the back of episode 3 just 3 years prior. I mean, I really don't think anyone asked for a kidnap plot involving Jabba the Hutt's son. But the film still provided some fun moments and exciting action scenes, most notably the opening on Christophsis and the vertical cliffside battle on Teth. Being the first attempt, the CGI left a lot of room for improvement, with fairly rigid animations in places, but the now definitive art style still holds a certain charm in its early stages. Moving on to the actual series, I think it's best to say now that as someone who has sat through every single episode from season 1 to season 7, I can confidently admit that there is an inconsistency throughout when it comes to the quality in both storytelling and production. Now, this isn't to say that it's unwatchable. At its weakest points, the episodes that I found a bit of a drag were only so because they were usually placed back to back with the really engaging ones. This was more commonplace in the first couple of seasons before the larger story arcs came into play. One episode had me struggling to keep my focus whilst Padme investigated a conspiracy in the Senate, who cares? But then the next episode had me on the edge of my seat for a full-scale invasion on Geonosis, with a devastating ground assault that, at the time, felt like someone took the beach landing scene from Saving Private Ryan and shoved it into a Saturday morning cartoon. Great stuff. Now, if you have the time and patience to watch every episode, I have no reason to suggest otherwise. If you want a speedier and arguably better viewing, then I'd recommend researching online into watch guides for the series so you can filter out some of the filler episodes. I mean, ask yourself this question. Do you want to watch Jar Jar Binks attempt to masquerade as a Jedi for 20 minutes? Regardless, it is also worth noting that for some reason, a handful of episodes aired out of chronological order. For example, episode 16 of season 2, titled Cat and Mouse, is chronologically the first episode of the entire series, even taking place before the film release. I have no idea why this was done. On my first viewing of the series, it never seemed like an artistic choice, and there's nothing to hint when an episode is actually taking place months, if not years, before the episode you just watched previously. Thankfully, if you want to watch the series in chronological order, you can find the full list on Star Wars' website, which I will link below. You might be getting the idea that I didn't actually enjoy my experience with the Clone Wars, but that's where you're wrong. When this show is good, my God, is it good.
It is badass.
At its best moments, this show can offer some of the best Star Wars content out there, and in some cases helps to elevate themes and key moments in the mainline films, such as the reason as to why the clone troopers so willingly carried out Order 66, or at least so we thought. All your favourite cast of characters return, the likes of Obi-Wan, Anakin, Yoda, and so on. But for me, the really impressive element the Clone Wars managed to pull off was to make me care for the characters we didn't follow much in the films. Jedi such as Plo Koon and Shaak-Ti, villains like Asajj Ventress, who received a much more emotional weight in the series than the 2003 run, and in my opinion, the most impactful of them all, the clones. They are in the name of the show after all, but it was a stroke of genius to make an army of the same looking, same sounding men in the numbers of
200,000 units are ready, with a million more well on the way.
Somehow, the emotional backbone of the entire series. Rex, Fives, Echo, Tup, Heavy, 99, and Gregor, to name just a few. All voiced by the talented Bradley D. Baker, yet still unique and memorable, providing some of the hardest hitting moments in the entire Star Wars canon. In my opinion, if you were to watch this show for one reason only, their stories would be it. Heading into the final season, it would be the clones once again that would steal the spotlight for me. Well, them, and maybe one other character. Ahsoka Tano is a character exclusive only to Star Wars animation, at least right now. And while she didn't receive the most welcome introduction of all time, she has now become a fan favourite, and it's not hard to see why. In particular, her storyline between episodes 17 and 20 of season 5 is one of the strongest in the series. It's really compelling stuff. Both Ahsoka and the clone stories come together perfectly in the final four episodes of the final season. This arc especially feels more like a full-length feature film than simply four episodes of easy TV viewing, with seemingly enhanced visuals and a higher production value than we've ever seen before. Not to mention the fact they include an homage to the original Lucasfilm production card and use the main theme for Star Wars instead of the Clone Wars theme to open the arc. Watching the few opening minutes of this arc, I was just giddy. It's so fun, and so Star Wars, it's just great. The arc eventually merges into the events of episode 3, and the way they're able to use moments from the film to influence the ending to this series was perfect. There's no better way to say it. I feel like it's worth mentioning, but it could be classed as a spoiler unless you've seen Solo, and then you will already know what I'm about to say. But basically, they brought Maul back. I mean, for a character that only says 31 words in The Phantom Menace, Darth Maul was definitely one of the highlights of the film. The lightsaber fight between Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon is still my favourite throughout the entire saga, just beating out Anakin versus Obi-Wan in episode 3. He is given a really cool storyline once he's introduced, and without spoiling anything, I will just say he is now more important to the canon than anyone could have ever predicted back in 1999. Given it was made after the prequel trilogy finished, there are some small inconsistencies and moments where you'll have to suspend your disbelief a little. In episode 3, for example, Grievous says to Obi-Wan,
"You fool! I've been trained in your Jedi arts by Count Dooku.
As if to suggest they've never squared off before. But they have. Many, many times thanks to the Clone Wars. Also, given how much impact Ahsoka has in the series, and especially on Anakin in the final few episodes, the fact he never mentions her name in Revenge of the Sith is a little odd now, but it's really not an issue. Ultimately, Dave Filoni and the team behind the series definitely should be commended for their work. Like I said, when it's good, it's some of the best Star Wars out there. And it's no surprise that Filoni was one of the small number of directors hired to help bring the equally good Mandalorian show to the small screen. This guy knows his stuff, and I'm excited to see what he does next with the franchise. That's all I've really got to say. Give it a watch if you haven't, and once you're done with that series, maybe we can talk about its follow-up, Star Wars Rebels. Hey everyone, thanks again for watching. Apologies for doing two Star Wars videos in a row, but for the next video I plan to go back to video games, hopefully making a video on The Last of Us 2 as it comes out tomorrow. I hope to see you all again, and in the meantime, stay safe out there. Peace.